Well, friends, today is the 28th session for Inspiring Conversations. We have been doing this for the last couple of years. The objective is learning from the experiences of others. And today amongst us, we have a stalwart personality, a great successful Indian who has not only made his mark in India, but is internationally renowned. I would like to request Mr. Dilip Chhabria to please come and join me on stage. Friends, I am not going to introduce this guest today. He needs no introduction. He is Dilip Chhabria. His work speaks for himself. His work has been experienced and enjoyed by a lot of people, not only across India, across Europe and Northern America. The concept of Inspiring Conversations is how we can pick up the main points from successful entrepreneurs, from their experiences, include them in our working style as entrepreneurs, and without going through the learning curve, just map it up the way we work and become more successful. So I would like to, without much introduction about him, I would like to understand him as we get into the conversations. So you have been a student of design and you are very passionate about design. I know many professionals who are good at what they do, but they have miserably failed when they come into business. As an entrepreneur, being a professional, a very creative person, having an international experience of working in your young days in the United States of America in Detroit, which is considered the heaven for automobile and the Mecca of industry for the automobile sector, after working for General Motors in the design section, you plan to come back to India. You start your accessories business, which you successfully run it for 10 years. There you understand the customers' moods, the thoughts, the taste, their needs, the budgets, and then you think of venturing into the design sector of automobiles. What was your thought process during this journey from being a student to an employee to an automobile accessories dealer to an entrepreneur?
Okay, so I think it starts with the basic tenet of your passion. And I guess, looking back, one has to have obsessive passion to really do something that he enjoys every day of his life. And therefore, my story was that, like most youngsters who go on to get educated in the West, because there was no such course in India, forget such a course, but there were no job opportunities as well. I'm talking of the late 70s, where the automotive industry really was only the Fiats and Ambassadors, and there was no incentive to really put new cars on the road. In fact, the government did not allow any new car manufacturing to happen. I don't know if some of you know, but there was a penalty even if you produce one car more than you were licensed, and the license capacity was 35,000. So it was from that era that one went abroad and you actually took up a job in one of the great brands, General Motors, Ford. And so I worked with General Motors. But having gotten there, I realized that, I will not be able to design a car, and that's the sole reason why I went for that course, till I attained seniority 25, 30 years into the job. And I guess I wasn't willing to wait that long, and I wasn't willing to give 30 years of my life in building General Motors brand equity. I think coming from an entrepreneurial family, I thought, let me go back and be the master of all that I survey. And that's how I started the accessory business, because that's the closest I could get to cars. Because in the late 70s, if I went to my parents or if I went to my banker and said I want to be designing cars, they would think I'm a lunatic.
So you're not an entrepreneur. You're a passionpreneur who brought the skills to the table and came out with a very successful organization.
No, but my sense, what I was trying to say that was that when you're obsessively passionate, you want to practice your craft each day. So you build, I have had to build a company to actually, practice my craft. Because if I did sketches, who would I go to build? There was no one. And therefore, I realized that I just don't want to do anything else in my life other than design cars of what I was passionate about, also what I was educated in.
When you look back, Mr. Dilip, when you look back, is it a good point that there is no competition to you, or would that be a bigger growth to you if there would have been competition? Because in the sector of automobile design, when if I want a fashion designer, I want a dress designer, or if I want an interior decorator or an exterior architect or whatever, there are so many of them available. When you talk about a car design, only one name appears all the time, that is Dilip Chhabria. So the lack of competition, is it good or bad?
It's both. I think if there was competition, the market size would have been bigger. But honestly saying, it's a great thing, because, you know, I realize when I meet some of my associates and they are in such a competitive scenario, it's almost impossible to make money, or it's impossible to have such a high standard of living. I mean, it's a good thing, because no customer of mine can actually ever come up and say, oh, somebody's offering us X price this or X minus this. So we have that elasticity of pricing. Because of that, we have been able to price ourselves out of certain sectors and go up the value chain, maybe more yield per square foot, more yield per employee. And because of no competition, because our spreads are very high, we are able to plow back a lot back into R&D, which actually feeds back into our brand equity.
Fantastic. Since 1993 that you started this business, you have grown to 600 people team, and you have got more than 700 designs to your credit. So this journey since 1993 till date, making your passion into a business model, what were the major elements for your success? Because when the professional gets into an entrepreneurship, he either fails on finance management, or he fails on the sales part, or he fails on the HR part. Some element he fails, and he again gets into the job model or a partnership where he's almost like a working partner. So what was it with you in this journey since 1993?
I think again it stems from the fact that you're obsessively passionate and you want to practice your craft. And the first thrust of success, you become captive to the organization, because your needs are more than the organizational needs. Why? Because you want to live that life. And therefore, you assume a lot of humility. And a lot of people are actually surprised at my humility, and they think it's a put-on. But it's not a put-on, because it's a beast that you create, and you've got to feed it. But in that sense, I think because you endear yourself to your employees, to your stakeholders, to your customers, a case in point, you guys have been following us up, I'm here. Would you have actually imagined the perception that I have? Do you think it was easy for you to get me here? No. So that's the perception, which is okay from that point of view, but why the organization worked and ticked, because each one felt they were doing a great job. They were being led by a benevolent leadership, not by a despotic, idiosyncratic, creative entrepreneur. So, you know, all those things put together, I think makes the organization tick.
So, parents give birth to film stars and other stars.
Yeah.
You gave birth to a hero car. Yeah. And there was a film made on it.
Yeah, that's
who gave you that idea? Was it branding?
No. I mean, many a times after the film was released, you know, it was a box office failure. But it was the number one grossing film every single year on television. Even beating Three Idiots, it's the number one grossing film. So the producers rang me up after the first year and he said, you know, we have a major problem and people are asking me, how much did DC pay you? And whereas it was the reverse. They paid us a lot of money because we built three cars for them. So it was as simply that they wanted to really leverage our name and our design ability and all that. So, it's done wonders for us, because some of our cars have been featured in earlier films, Yash Chopra's films, and quite a few of Bollywood films. But I'm really amazed at the reach of Bollywood. I'm amazed. I mean, like you mentioned, I go to all these Ivy League institutions across the world, and they talk about this film. So I'm really amazed at the reach.
You get customers who are the high and the mighty and the powerful. How do you manage them? They are ready to spend a lot, but they are very demanding. Absolutely. So, how do you handle the customers? There are good ones also, there are bad ones also. There is good money also, there is bad money also. You make them the luxury 1 BHKs and the 2 BHKs on four wheels. How do you handle their pressure points as an entrepreneur?
No, I mean, it's commonly said that, you know, if you can't afford a house, you go to DC because it's even more than a house. But that's not... but having said that, I mean, yeah, because when we do some of these projects is, you know, 1.5 lakh rupees a square foot is our actually conversion rate. And we were trying to get into home interiors and we realized what a shitty business it was because nobody was willing to pay even 10,000 rupees a square foot. I said, forget it. You know, you don't mean that kind of business. But having said that, I think all people who come to us, our customers, are very well informed. So they are very serious people. It's serious money. So they're well researched. You get sometimes arrogant people. We have to put up with them. I don't interact personally with them. But you do get issues when you're dealing with some politicians. I don't know if you know, but about 3-4 months back, there was an FIR.
You were threatened.
There was an FIR filed by Raja Bhaiya because we did not deliver his vehicle. His vehicle has been lying ready in my Delhi operation for the last 7 months. There was a 21 lakh outstanding. He told him to clear the money and take the vehicle. He being he realized that, you know, he can put on the screws and make us dance.
He must have felt very odd because what gets against him is doing it against somebody else.
Yeah, so you get, that's probably part of business hazards of trade.
Whenever you talk about personalization in any business, it is a service sector. You are in
yes.
a service sector.
Yes.
Whenever you talk about personalization, every customer who's paying big money also has got high levels of satisfaction.
Yeah.
So you must be definitely encountering a lot of this kind of feedbacks after the product is delivered that the satisfaction level is not there. How have you trained your employees to manage such situations? Because as entrepreneurs, some of us who are in the service sector, also this is a major department to deal with customer satisfaction. How do you do that in your enterprise?
So we used to have these issues in the earlier years of operation because we really did not know how to handle this aspect. But we've learned how to manage those expectations. And I think you have to be honest to your trade. If the product is not so good, you might as well be honest and say, you know, product is not so good, give me some more time, let me correct it. Or if it's not good, just for the sake of not good, then you have to challenge it. But most of the time, we really don't have 99.99%. You don't have a problem because at the end of the day, I think if you're doing a good job, it shows.
You're one of the first people in India who converted designs into a product on automobiles. Like a design which was being done for one car, you customized it and you started mass producing it for vehicles like Innovas and the Fortuners and all other vehicles. So how do you get these ideas for expansion? How do you convert your limitations into your strengths? Do you have a core think tank? Do you have advisors on board? Or is it your own thoughts? How do you derive at that?
No, it's a culmination of the marketing feedback that we get and the inquiry base that we have across offices. And so we cull them, collate them, we really understand what's happening. But the underlying essence of our place under the sun is that we do what a manufacturer will not do or cannot do, either because of skill or because of scale. And we fit in that slot because, you know, manufacturers are geared to do much larger volumes. You know, they need 100,000 units. And we would come somewhere where even 2,000 units, 3,000 units are good enough. And therefore, they would not be interested. We already have built that brand equity to end customer. So he is able to you know, have the confidence that we're going to deliver to him. So it all actually fits into, basically it's a sum total of market positioning, presaging the future, and collecting the marketing feedback that you've had.
And with the line of business that you are into, how do you see expanding your marketplace? How do you do that? Do you do only advertising, it is referral marketing, or how do you penetrate the market within the India, within the country? And how could you reach out to the other parts of the world, especially Europe, where your designs have been implemented by the automotive majors?
Yeah.
How do you plan to do that? How do you do that exactly? How would you convince a European brand to get you on board for getting their designs done? Because it's always a bias there on whom you get the work done from, especially the designs for which the companies are known for.
Yeah, so at this point of time, we are not looking at Europe from the customizing point of view.
OEM point of view?
We are not looking at that from an OEM point of view because we believe that India is such a huge market by itself. We haven't even seeded India in that sense. But you might know, or some of you guests might know, that we also now car manufacturers. We have the sports car, which we have launched 1.5 year back. So for that, we are looking at.
Should I have the courage to ask the price point?
It's 36,93,000. We are very successful.
That's all.
Yeah, and you can have a look at it on the net. It's called the Avanti. We are looking at that product to be exported to Europe. There are a lot of regulatory issues that we may have to overcome, but somewhere 2-3 years down the line, that's a distinct possibility.
In your organization, what is the kind of leadership role that you play? Because jaisa raja vaisi praja, it all depends on what the boss thinks and how he behaves. So what is the kind of leadership that you like to identify for us to pick up from you?
Well, I think if you have a stable employee base, and you might be quite shocked to know that we have had no employee turnover, not even 1%. Now, why is that so? Is because I think each one of them came to work excited for that day, knowing that he's going to do something which he didn't do yesterday. I think that it's not about money. It's about the creativity of new things every single day of your life. And within that aspect, to be able to get freedom, for me, I tell them, if not taking a risk is a bigger risk. So I implore them to really try out new ideas, fail, no problem, learn from it, and go. That is how we have grown, actually. So I think they are empowered. They don't feel they are working. We have a very college atmosphere. My HR guys, at loggerheads with me because he says these guys are coming late and they are going late. And I said, look, just leave it. They are delivering a lot more than you can ever think of. So, give them the freedom. At the end of the day, you have to see the output.
You are strict on creatives. You are strict on your designs. How is quality control happening in your organization? Since this is all related to finesse and really getting the product well done.
Of course, we have quality control departments inward, when they receive the goods and all that. But I think in that sense.
Is this something different that you do? Because everybody has a quality control department.
Yeah, we are different in the sense I pride us as being a flat organization. And we were always a flat organization. And I used to first defend myself by saying, we have some managers, they are on leave, blah, blah, blah. And then I read an interview with Mr. Ratan Tata, and he said one of his biggest disappointments, having retired from Tata Sons and therefore was not having achieved to make Tata Motors a flat organization. And that kind of hit me hard. I said, here I have a flat organization, and I'm defending myself. I should actually be proud of it. So within that measure, each and every person within the organization is a quality control check. Now, I'll give you an example. So as I said, there has been no employee turnover. So there's a cultural DNA built of creativity and quality. It's not, nothing is written down, but you can feel it, you can sense it, it's in the memes. And therefore, many a times, at least 2-3 times a year, when I'm sitting up late, sometimes on Saturday or Sunday, I'm going to work, and my peon, who's also 25 years with me now, he would come up to me and said, that color doesn't look nice.
So you take feedbacks.
Yeah, and then I think, I said, he's right. Maybe he's escaped my notice because I'm so hard-pressed for time, hard-pressed to deliver the car, but he's actually right. Now, what gave him the temerity to actually suggest this color is wrong, but he was actually right, and I agreed with him. So this essence gets built up into the DNA of the company.
So do you also create the accessories yourself, or you get it sourced and then you assemble it together? How does it operate?
Everything that we do in our cars is produced by us, because there doesn't exist another organization that is able to supply us. Even if there was, I'm sure there will be, but we don't have the volumes to justify. And also, we are very paranoid about you know, giving away our IPR drawings and things like that. So we really innovate. We do a lot of R&D, but we retain it within the company.
You took the name of Tata. I would like to ask you a question. Who's your second line of leadership? What are you building as a second line of leadership? Because designs is a very personalized line of business.
Yeah.
So what have you done for the second line of leadership?
Well, we have a lot of managers within the company, as I said, who have been with us for 20, 25 years. My Bombay operation runs independently of me. And actually, we are competing sometimes between Pune, Gurgaon and Bombay on designs. The fact that I have not even visited my Bombay office for the last 4 months and customer satisfaction is so high, it means we are delivering. So as you know, there's so much of grooming that has happened and being and having no employee turnover. I think they are capable of really taking over. I hope to work till I'm 75, 80 for sure, because that is going to be my privilege. And just, you know, I was reading a very nice article in Time magazine, and that said that all creative people, be it artists, poets, you know, whatever, they actually live longer life is because they're enjoying every day of their life. I never thought of that that way. You can research that.
We will all regret not being creative.
Yeah, I guess so.
How do you plan your next growth stage? One is you got into accessories, then you got into customization of vehicles, then you got the multiplication of the designs in the mass way as a product. Now you have got into the car production. Yeah. When you have designs, capabilities and skills, have you also done it for other products like a yacht or a private jet, or is it restricted only to the automobiles?
No. We like to stimulate our organization in trying to cater to other segments. So we have done a private jet where we actually sent a team to Saudi Arabia, and we scanned the whole jet interior, and we actually built all the substrates in India, and we actually went and fitted out there. It's on my website. You can see that. Essentially, because that tests the organization. It stimulates the organization. Yachts, not yet. We have aspirations because there's not enough good maritime history in India as yet. But automotive design is a motherlode of all industries.
They are the most expensive people as far as designs are concerned.
No, for the simple reason that each car that you put on the road is $1 billion.
$1 billion, yes.
There's no other product. Not a phone, not a yacht, not even an aircraft. So the reason is because you've got to produce 100,000 cars. Each car is, you know, waterproof, vibration, safety.
And not only the engine, it is the design which sells. Because there are some products in the market with the car companies where some designs oversell and some don't. So that is the difference of the design.
Exactly.
So design clearly plays a critical role.
Show me a car that has succeeded in India and I'll show you design. Show me a car that has failed in India,
and it's
I'll show you
design.
And I'm only talking of India. It is increasingly relevant to other parts of the world, more so, not less so. So,
fantastic. What is your personal learning curve? How do you educate yourself onto getting better designs and better products?
It's simple. I mean, we marketeers build ourselves barriers and segments, but it's simple. A thing of beauty is a joy forever. Sex sells, as simple as that. So you don't have to really rethink. Every single time you have to attempt doing something that somebody has not done the last 50, 60 years, and that's very difficult. And also as designers, you've got to do something at least 10 years hence, because even if your design is approved now, it's going to be 5 years by the time it hits the road. Then it has to be current for the next 5 to 7 years to sell. And then the last guy is going to use, the last guy who bought it at the 11th year from your mind idea, he's going to drive it for another 7, 8 years. So it's 20 years. That means a worth of a design is measured if his designs have lasted for 20 years.
Fantastic. What I would like to ask you is, when we are into retail business, pricing is a very critical element. There are different ways how an entrepreneur will price his product or service. What are your pricing mechanisms?
Well, our pricing mechanisms are based on leveraging, optimizing every man hour that we have, because we are not going to be increasing our workforce so fast, because these are all high skills. It takes years.
So is the pricing mechanism done consciously?
Yes, absolutely. It's on a man hour basis. And therefore, what we find now is that when I started the company, I was catering to the youth, you know, who came to us for the car to look different. We are no longer able to do that product because we have priced ourselves out. And therefore, we have to resort to products like the interior comfort, like you mentioned on the Innova, where we invest in one program and create an assembly line. So, pricing is a purpose of, what is going to cost you to sustain your organization, and therefore, who is going to be able to pay you that price? Is it going to be some youngster who is going to wanting his car to look different? No. So, who next? You know, that's how it goes.
So, with the advent of your car that you have launched, DC Avanti, you are now getting into the rat race of competition and selling cars, appointing distributors, service centers. How do you plan doing that? That is suddenly going to be a different scale altogether. And is it the right decision? Because I've seen many who have done so well through their life, and at a point of time, they take one right decision and they multiply their wealth. They take one wrong decision and the wealth disappears. Yeah, what is your calculation behind that?
So you're right. I mean, at this point of time, I do not know whether it's a right decision or wrong decision. Maybe a couple of years will decide that.
What is your risk mitigation behind that decision?
There is no risk mitigation. My only risk mitigation is that every single time I took a certain step in life, for example, in 1993, to start a DC design business, first year I felt I've done the wrong thing. Then in 2005, when I had to shift my base to Pune, I felt I've done the wrong thing. And every time I felt I've done the wrong thing, over the next 2-3 years, it's proven right. So I'm hoping that this also proves right. I think the point is that it's not in the rat race as such as you're saying, because this car is not going to have any competition. The Tatas and Mahindras of the world are not going to be making a car like this. So how does an Indian youth get his hands on a sports car? Because a Ferrari and Lamborghini is out of his reach. And if we were capable of doing it, I realize it's worth taking the risk, because like they say, you know, a man's reach must exceed his grasp, or what are heavens for. So I mean, I'm trying to dare and dream and things like that. I hope it works. Otherwise, I don't know, whatever we read in the newspapers and magazines is all hogwash.
Fantastic. When I was in college, one last point I would like to make here before you open the house to the questions.
Yeah.
When I was in college, a friend of mine, his father wanted to import the Mahindra tractors to Russia.
Right.
The first order was 300 tractors. And when he met the management of Mahindras, they refused the sale, because they said that whenever we enter a market, we install our service centers first to ensure that the after-sale service is in place, and then we do the sales. In this case, we are not ready for the market, so we won't take up the sale.
Right.
How have you planned the expansion of your product sale in the form of Avanti across the country?
So we have three operations, is Bombay, Pune and Delhi. And we are concentrating our market around these areas where we can service. Because for our company, I mean, India is such a big market, it will make no sense to spread ourselves thin. And these markets are actually good enough number-wise to really keep us busy.
Fantastic. Friends, this is all for you. My time is up. I already got a cue card. So, questions please. Quick. We'll take 5 to 7 questions. So, we have to be really quick. Sidhu.
Yeah, first of all, congratulations to you. You are the Michelangelo of this, car design thing.
Oh, thank you.
And we wish that you should live more than 100 years.
I hope so.
Yeah. The question is, you have created the masterpieces. Now, when you create a masterpiece, the scalability gets smart. So, how did you balance this? And my second question is, are you mentoring any next generation DC?
Okay, the answer, first part of your question is that as long as you are still a decimal fraction of the market size, it really doesn't trade off on the exclusivity part of it at all. In fact, it it helps it. Because you're still maybe 20, 30 cars in a city. And, you know, that's nothing. The second part of your question, yes, of course, we are always mentoring DCs. Because that's how, you know, we can only grow. Because each of the 700 people that work with us are DCs in that manner. And I realized earlier on that as an artist or as a designer, my output of 2,000 hours per year is only going to give me so much, you know, growth or so much revenue or so much income. So my challenge was, how do I make that into 100x, 200x, 300x? And therefore, that's how we, you know, I had to create this organization. Otherwise, you won't find designers owning entrepreneurial or owning factories. They never do that because they're not geared to.
It's very rare.
Yeah, they are more on the right brain side. They don't want to get into the headaches of doing all these things.
So just extension to this question, you know, you are definitely able to, you know, create the army of designers.
Right.
But have you been able to create any generals?
I'm sure, you know, if I am actually far removed today, maybe I am the biggest impediment of creating the generals because I'm there, because I have nothing else to do. But if I was away, they are competent enough. For example, the Delhi and the Bombay operations run without me. And they are my biggest money-making operations. Pune is actually a guzzler where I am situated.
So next question. Yes,
good evening, sir. My question to you is that you have designed the DC Avanti and plan to get into manufacturing of it. The other option would have been designing the DC Avanti and go to a car manufacturer who would do that for you. So what made you think that I should go for manufacturing an entire car rather than leasing it? Or
okay, so the answer is that we are already manufacturing. It's not about planning. We are already doing that. To answer your question, there is no such facility within the country to produce such a car. Because this is a low-volume car, so the processes that have been followed are pretty much the processes that Ferrari and Lamborghini follow. It is not an assembly line method. Now, if I were to go to Ferrari and Lamborghini, obviously they won't do business for us. And if they do business for us, they'll charge me, what, 100 euros an hour. My cost is 10 euros an hour. So there was no one else I could go to. And the reason why I wanted to do desperately, because when I was 18 and 19 years old, I used to hanker my father to buy me a sports car. I could never get one. Once in a blue moon, there used to be a car that came into STC. At that time, you had STC, where the diplomats used to sell cars to STC when they left the country. And the car would go at 10 times and 12 times of the reserve price, because each and every young male wants to have a sports car. So I realized that if I had the capability and if I were able to take the risk, financial risk, why don't I do it? Because that's how Ferrari started, Lamborghini started. I'm sure each one starts in a small way. You have to have the belief in your capability and the risk.
Last two questions. Yeah, Mr. Kishore.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
According to you, what is the definition of success? Number one. Number two, today we have Global Indian Reality Summit and everybody is talking about affordability in India. What is the definition of affordability according to DC?
Oh, that's really a tough one. I don't think it's a question of affordability. I think it is going to be a question of can we make a product that evokes a lust in you? You cannot sleep. You want to get the product.
Okay.
So you will stretch yourself. You will stretch yourself and make sure that you afford one.
Okay. And first one, what is the definition of success? According to you?
Well, definition of success is that, you know, it's a perception where people feel, oh, you have achieved so much, you're so rich and all that, but you go out of this door and you're very insecure, you do not know whether you will survive tomorrow. So that's the contradiction of success.
Yes.
Okay. Hello.
I just wanted...
We'll take the lady first?
Yeah.
Sorry.
I'm sorry. Okay.
Yeah.
You are doing a good job, but the thought of using the infrastructure and the conditions of the road, taking that into consideration, didn't it make you to think it twice? And if not, then you are a very courageous person.
In fact, the roads are good for the automobile companies. No, the more the cars break, the more are bought.
For this, for the sports car.
No, I'd like to believe that I'm very courageous because that's a nice tag to have. It's not a nice tag to have to be timid, obviously. But, you know, one of the reasons why a car, I mean, we have sold quite a few of them in tier two cities is because it was designed in India. So if you our sports car, what you're referring to is at 165 millimeter ground clearance. If it was 170 millimeters, madam, that would be classified as an SUV and I would have to pay 3% more excise duty. So having a sports car, which is almost like an SUV, what better can I give you for a country like this?
Yes, Sudhir.
I'm very much fond of you, DC.
Sure, thank you.
When is the production? When is the production target date
of
Avanti.
Avanti?
It's already produced.
It's on the road since last 1 year. There are so many in Bombay itself.
Okay.
It's already on the.
It is available with you.
Yes, yes, yes.
So I would like to have.
Yes, of course. of course.
Yes, Anto.
Yeah. Hello. Good evening, sir. Normally, a new platform of car cost anywhere between 500 crores to 1,600 crores, depending on who's making it.
Yeah.
So your platform, you know, what would have been the budget and did you had funding for it?
No.
That's my first question. And second will be, do you track all the customized cars about the accident history? Do you have a tracking system or, you know, just to prove that, you know, everything is fine?
To answer your first question is that we funded the car through our internal accruals. The whole project outlay was 200 crores, which is really a bargain. It's because we were customers to ourselves. You know, we design cars for most multinational companies. I'm sure you would be aware. We design cars for BMW, Aston Martin, Ford, General Motors. So we said, why don't we take a risk on ourselves? So obviously, we had to fund it ourselves. We have not got any equity funding. We hope to look at that in the near future. The next question was, as far as the tracking of the Avanti is concerned, of course, it's got a real-time tracking system from a customer's point of view. It's part of the OBD2 requirements from a regulation point of view. As far as the custom cars are concerned, it doesn't require anything except that with the brand image that we have to be ultra responsive to a customer. Otherwise, we'll lose it because the expectation, like he said, the expectation on us is much higher than the expectation from a Mercedes-Benz. And therefore, if we are serious about remaining in business, we better take each customer seriously.
Do you have to get ARAI approval for each customization or?
No. It's only for the sports car because that's our own platform. But for custom cars, as long as they're not doing any structural change, there are no... ARAI is not empowered to give you the permissions and nor are RTOs. So you don't do any structural changes as long as the gross vehicle weight remains the same.
Yes, Amol.
Good evening, sir. Since your market being a very niche market,
yeah.
How did you actually market your services maybe when you started, you know, because that time it would have been a challenge to take it to people.
No, I think, as I said, you know, a thing of beauty is a joy forever. I think we were helped back because the car is a dynamic product. It moves around. So the first car was a Maruti Gypsy that we did in 1993. And wherever I went, I mean, that was not done for, it was in 1992. It was not I hadn't decided to really start a business. I did it for myself. And wherever it would go, if I went to the race course for a walk and I would come back and people would gather around the car, if I went to a restaurant, people would wonder, you know, where is this, and who made it, and blah, blah, blah. And then we had a big thing in Times of India because it's such a new thing, you know. Somebody comes to you, he gives you a car, he gives you so much money, and he wastes so much time, they must be stupid and all that. So I think we got famous very fast because the car is a rolling dynamic object. And if it's a well-designed car, it really stands out. So you have people following you, you have, you know, scooterists and motorbike people you know, trying to...
It's like a hero on the road.
Yeah, so, you know...
Smriti.
So it builds up very fast, word of mouth.
Thank you.
Good evening, Mr. Chhabria. I wanted to know, what stage of design do you get involved in? You mentioned Mumbai is autopilot. Does that mean that those designs don't go through you? Or does that mean that it just...
Yeah, Mumbai and Delhi designs don't go to me. And therefore, it's only very, very challenging projects or very exciting projects. I make sure it comes to me because that's a privilege I have since I own the company. And I am only involved in the germination of the idea or just pen the lines. And then you have the whole team that kind of builds up on that and surfaces, engineering, blah, 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 and all that. So the design essence is the few lines that you pen.
So the initial stage?
Absolutely, absolutely initial stage.
Okay.
And then, of course, you keep overseeing it as it evolves. And something that jars, you correct it. But otherwise, you let it go.
Okay.
So thanks a ton. That was a lovely session. And due to paucity of time, I've already got the cue card. I would like to request Lakshmi and Manish Maheshwari to please come up and give a moment to our guest, the chief guest for the evening today. And that was a brilliant session. Thanks a lot, Mr. Chhabria. We really enjoyed it. Friends, today we are making a large announcement, and the announcement is we are now venturing into the sector of football and futsal. Everybody has heard about the Premier Futsal League. It is the world's largest league, which is being conducted by a family from India, from Chennai, and the owner of the league is here. I would like to request her to come up on stage, Vimla, and her partners Abhinandan as well as Nitya. And in your presence, we would like to announce that St. Angelo's VNCT Ventures is proud to announce that we have taken the Chennai team, which is named as St. Angelo's VNCT Chennai Singhams. I would like to request Vimla to give us the logo, and I would like to request Shugra, Nagu and Geeta to come up on stage, please, to receive the logo from Vimla officially over an event. Vimla, you can come here with them. Friends, the Indian Premier Futsal League will be played between the 15th of September to the 1st of October. It is going to be played in Mumbai. It is going to be played in Bangalore, Delhi and Dubai. Sheikh Hamdan in Dubai, the son of Sheikh Mohammed, is personally involved in the tournament. They have given us a red carpet welcome in Dubai. And this tournament is the highest viewed event in India after the IPL, the last year. This is the first time where players like Ronaldinho, Ryan Giggs, Scholes, Deco, those kind of stalwarts are involved in a game. And this game is made in India since it is played in India. So this has gone to more than 85 countries. This year it will go to almost all the countries on planet Earth. This year the response will be phenomenally higher. The teams playing this tournament are Chennai, Mumbai, Hyderabad, Bangalore, Delhi and Gujarat. So you will be seeing a lot of action. This is going to create a lot of eyeballs. And we will make sure that the Premier Futsal League crosses a viewership that even IPL has in this country. Because it is global. Cricket playing countries are less. Football and futsal playing countries are maximum in this world. So this game is going to be live telecasted by Sony. And as a company, St. Angelo's VNCT Ventures, we are really proud to be a part of this activity. Thanks a ton, friends.